Last time we talked about representing functions as power series. Now we're going to talk about doing calculus with those functions, in particular, taking derivatives and integrals. So here's the big theorem. So let's suppose that you've got a function that's represented by a power series. And let's suppose that that power series has a radius of convergence r. Then as long as we are within the radius convergence, not on the boundary, not outside, you have to be strictly inside the radius of convergence, then the derivative of the function is given by this formula, which is just the derivative of this term by term. The derivative of a0 is 0. The derivative of a1x is a1. The derivative of a2x squared is twice a2x. The derivative of a3x cubed is 3a3x squared. You get this power series for the derivative by just taking the derivative of every single term. And that's easy, because we all know how to take derivatives of powers of x. And the same thing goes for integrals. If you want to understand what the integral of a function is, you just take the integral of every term. The integral of a0 is a0x. The integral of a1x is a1x squared over 2. The integral of a2x squared is a2x cubed over 3. And so on. In other words, to integrate a power series or to differentiate a power series, just do it one term at a time. Use the ordinary power rule for derivatives and integrals and go to it. Now, this is a math class, and whenever we have a theorem, we have to understand why it works. So the first thing to notice is that all three functions, whether you're talking about the formula for the function, the derivative, or the integral, that they all have the same radius of convergence. And that's, you can get that by using the ratio test. If you apply the ratio test to the original function, you're interested in the limit of an plus 1 over an, and that's some number. If you apply the ratio test to the derivative involves n plus 1 an plus 1 x to the n. So the nth term divided by the n minus first term looks just like this, only got a factor of n plus 1 upstairs and n downstairs. But in the limit, that doesn't affect the ratio. The limit of n plus 1 over n is 1. So whatever this is the same limit. And when you do an integral, you divide by something. You divide by something that looks like n or n plus 1 or n plus 2. And the fact that you're dividing the top and the bottom by n plus 1 and n plus 2 doesn't change the limit doesn't change the ratio in the limit. So in other words, all three series have exactly the same radius convergence. That doesn't mean they have the same interval of convergence. It's possible that on the boundary, one of them converges while another one doesn't. But they have the same radius of convergence. So now let's suppose we're working within the radius of convergence. Within the radius of convergence, we know that the limit of a finite sum is the infinite sum. That's what it means to converge. An infinite sum is just a limit of a finite sum. So we can write f of x as a finite sum, the sum of the first capital N terms. We think of capital N being a million or a billion or a trillion, plus a really small remainder. And the bigger capital N is, the smaller that remainder is. And then we just integrate it. The integral of little f is the integral of all of these, the first n terms, plus the integral of the small remainder. Well, the integral of a polynomial is easy. We know how to integrate a polynomial. And the integral of something small is small. And that means that as you take more and more and more terms, this expression gets closer and closer and closer to the integral. So the integral really and truly is given by the infinite sum. It's the limit of the finite sum as you take more and more and more terms. And by definition, that's the infinite sum. And that gives you the integral. Okay, that's the integral. How do we do the derivative? Well, the derivative we get by applying that argument to the derivative. So let's take this expression, which this is the expression that we think gives us our derivative. And to see that it's really our derivative, we integrate it. So we use the same argument as before, and we get that the integral of g of s ds from 0 to x, in other words, the indefinite integral of g of x dx, is given by, well, the integral of nx to the n minus 1 is x to the n, and this is what we have. And that's exactly the formula for f of x, except for the leading constant. Now we take the derivative of both sides. By the fundamental theorem of calculus, the derivative of the integral is the original function. But the derivative of this is f prime. So this expression must be f prime. In other words, f prime of x is given by this formula. So that's it for the theorem. Now, I did the theorem for powers of x, but we could just as well have done the theorem for powers of x minus 1 or x minus 2, or more generally, x minus a. And I apologize a little bit for the notation that I'm using the same letter for the coefficients as for the thing we're expanding around. It's not a big deal, but an is coefficients, a is 1 or 2 or 3 or whatever you're expanding around. It says, if you have a power series, then as long as you're within the radius of convergence, the derivative is gotten by taking the derivative of each term, and the integral is gotten by taking the integral of each term. And here I've written it as an indefinite integral, so you need the plus C.